So why is SpaceX planning to drop the Starship into the sea? Well, there are a few reasons for this. First and foremost, it's important to understand that the Starship is still in the testing phase. In order to ensure that it is ready for its planned missions, it needs to undergo a series of tests to check its systems and capabilities. Hello and welcome to our latest video, where we'll be discussing SpaceX's upcoming plans to drop their Starship spacecraft into the sea. SpaceX is close to landing a Starship at sea. The race between SpaceX and NASA to send monster rockets into space has won over the government. SLS is finally blowing up the launch pad and putting more pressure on Elon Musk's company to launch Starship. But there are still steps to be taken before Starship can prepare for an orbital launch. SpaceX continues to add more engines to the Starship. The Starship will only grow and so will the spectacle, and it will be enough to see Booster 7 powering all 33 Raptors for the first time. There is no exact timetable, but since SpaceX tends to move fast, and the company plans to launch Booster 7 next month and ship 24, a fast move should be expected. This fateful flight begins less than 2 minutes after taking off from Starbase, Texas. The Super Heavy booster separates from the ship's booster, then partially returns and lands in the Gulf of Mexico. Or is captured by the Starship's orbital launch tower, while returning to Starbase. The Raptor's engines were expected to develop an orbital speed of about 28,000 kilometers per hour, and make a smooth controlled landing at sea. And then shut down approximately 8 minutes 41 seconds after the start of the mission. Northern Hawaii, 62 miles or 100 kilometers from the furthest island. Musk tweeted that this would be 3/4 of the way around the Earth, and that observers would be farther apart than the usual 6.2 miles or 10 kilometers. That up and down orbit jump observers travel, and that is a precaution they go out of orbit more than 10 kilometers. The Pacific Ocean would be needed to minimize the risk of re-entry collision. The flight of this first attempt will end in 5,420 seconds, approximately 90 minutes after launch. At the end of the mission, the spacecraft will still be in the water with no landing pad and no one to catch it. But why SpaceX try to land S-24 spacecraft into the water instead of landing it into Mechazilla? There are several good reasons for this decision. Well, if you're wondering why spaceships in orbit aren't trying to land on a starbase in Texas. Let me be clear that the first and most important reason for this is, of course, human safety. One of these tests is the belly flop maneuver, which involves the spacecraft flipping over and re-entering the Earth's atmosphere with its belly facing downwards. This allows for a controlled descent and landing, similar to how a skydiver would land. To simulate the conditions of this maneuver, SpaceX has decided to drop the Starship into the sea. This will allow them to test the spacecraft's ability to control its descent and landing, as well as its structural integrity when subjected to the forces of re-entry. This is because the orbital landing test flights did not start with nearly straight up and down trajectories, like the first prototype test flights. Even those trajectories were much more difficult than those of the engines. When the spacecraft was flying sideways and using full orbital speed. To be safe on re-entry, you need to re-enter the atmosphere somewhere on the other side of the ocean. If something goes wrong, it will cause problems for the experimental spacecraft, with the following experimental systems. Thus, his new thermal protection system will put us in the same position that we found ourselves in during the 2003 Space Shuttle Columbia disaster. Where spacecraft barrels have leaked all over the United States, we don't want this to happen again, and where they'll try to dismantle this orbital spaceship prototype. After flying apparently well thought out in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, the rotating part of the plane passes over the ocean, on a trajectory that ensures that all the debris will fall into the ocean if something goes wrong. The splash point is at a safe distance, but still very close to the Hawaiian island of Kauai. Since Hawaii is actually part of the United States, SpaceX can salvage the spacecraft and study the solid debris to gather potentially valuable information. While everyone else is safe and hassle-free of international barriers. Again, this is a SpaceX test vehicle. SpaceX is doing something radical that no other space company is doing. It's called rapid prototyping. At any given moment, building a product prototype will cost more than the cost of the final product. Even if it's just a manufacturing design estimate, it's derived from a physical representation that can be processed, tested, and evaluated, but if it's broken, process design, the need for one capital repairs. The time and cost of building something else, and rapid prototyping are now generally barriers to making physical models cheaply or quickly. Using them has become a pragmatic step in product development. The ability to iteratively build and modify prototype to become prototypes reduces overall design time. However, it's important to note that this is just a test and there is always a risk of failure. If the Starship does not successfully complete the landing, it could potentially flip over or even crash. Despite the risks, this test is an important step in the development of the Starship spacecraft. It will allow SpaceX to gather valuable data on the spacecraft's performance, and make any necessary adjustments before it is ready for its planned missions. As SpaceX engineers learn and adapt quickly, we can confidently build production-ready designs after the necessary iterations. Elon Musk relied on this iteration, and shortly after the first SpaceX Starship prototype passed in November 2019. SpaceX completed stress test to complete Starship SUOR Heavy Booster 7 and Starship Ship 24 for orbital launch. SpaceX Starship safe landing with the ultimate goal of building a reusable rocket, the concept didn't work out sooner. Failed, the company introduces a second Musk and names it SN1, or serial number 1, in the hope that others will build and test the machine as soon as possible. SpaceX engineers learned what worked and what didn't and, as Elon Musk put it, quickly passed it on to the next version of SpaceX. Failure was a necessary step as we headed to S24, for the Starship Maiden 25 orbiter HIP to connect the engine to another. Ring testing phase. Found parts for S27, 28, 29 and even S30. SpaceX is trying to build cheap mass-produced vehicles first and foremost, so damage of any kind is really far away. And obviously it is better to lose equipment, due to failure than to waste time launching Ship 24. SpaceX does not diminish the importance of this underwater mission, when it claims that the company aims to collect as much data as possible, during flights. In order to measure dynamics and better understand what vehicles experience in carefully timed flight modes. This data, which is difficult to accurately predict or reproduce, reinforces vehicle design concepts or operation concepts, after changes or flights and creates better models for use in internal simulations. Super Heavy won't be able to bring the entire mass of a Starship up to orbital speed all by itself. Meaning if the Starship didn't light its own engines, and use its own propellant, it would fall back down right in the Caribbean Sea. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.